Welcome back. I'm Professor Jim Kearns, and today's topic in statics is going to be the difference between defining vectors using coordinate angles and projection angles, and also we'll include some Cartesian coordinates in here. But the main thing is, students seem to struggle with coordinate angles versus projection angles. I touched on it in the review of vector video that I've done previously, but I wanted to take some time and just work out an example where we take a vector defined in magnitude and coordinate angle form. We'll take that vector, convert it to Cartesian coordinates, and then convert it into a form using projection angles. And then once we have that, we'll work the process in the other direction to get back to the coordinate angles. So that way we get a feel for how the process works going both ways and understand the difference when you see how we calculate each one. So get out your pencil and paper, follow along, pause the video where you need to so you can make sure you're doing the math same as I am, and away we go. So what we have specified here is we have this vector A specified with a magnitude of 7, I'll call it meters. The angle alpha of 73.4 degrees is the angle between the x-axis and that vector along, measured on that inclined plane formed by the axis and that vector. Okay. And beta is the angle from the y-axis to that vector on the plane, inclined plane formed by the y-axis and that vector. And then there's a third angle that we could specify, gamma, that would be between the z-axis and that vector, again, on yet another inclined plane. The thing we should do is calculate gamma, because once we have alpha and beta, gamma is not an independent parameter. You can't just pick any value at random, because we're constrained by the fact that the cosine of alpha squared plus the cosine of beta squared plus the cosine of gamma squared is equal to 1. And I'll run through a proof of that at the end of the video just to show you why that works. So if we plug in some numbers here, the cosine of alpha is 0.857, and then we're going to square that, and the cosine of beta is 0.8571, and we'll square that, and then we have the cosine of gamma squared equals 1. Rearranging it, we get the cosine of gamma equals the square root of 1 minus the 0.28 squared minus 0.85 squared. I'm skipping some digits here just to make life simpler. So the cosine of alpha is equal to plus or minus 0.4286, and it could be either, because there's two solutions, the square root. Taking the inverse cosine of the 4286, we get gamma is equal to either 64.6, or it's equal to 115.4 degrees. And looking at our diagram, the 64.6 number makes sense. Okay, so that gives us gamma. Okay, so now we have our vectors. To make it useful, what we'll typically do is convert it into Cartesian coordinates. If we want to convert this into Cartesian coordinates, we look at just the x-axis for a second. I have the x-axis here. I have my vector A, and I have an angle here between them that's equal to 73.4, and I know that I can find this x value. X equals the magnitude A times the cosine of 73.4. And I can repeat that process for the Y and the Z axes. And we can write our A vector equals A, the magnitude, times the cosine of 73.4 plus A times the cosine of our angle of beta between the y-axis and the vector, which we came up with 31 degrees, plus A cosine of gamma, which we said was 64.6 degrees. And when we do all the take the cosines and do the multiplication, we get our this is times J vector, this is times I vector, and this is times K vector. Forgot those. When we do all the math, we get A vector equals 2i vector plus 6j vector plus 3k vector. So that is our vector A in Cartesian coordinates. And I apologize for some of the writing here, but this pen is just giving me traces even when I don't touch the screen. Well, this gives us our vector in Cartesian coordinates, just the magnitude of the vector times the cosine of those angles. That makes it pretty easy, and we can do what we want here, and you know, if we want to add it to another vector or whatever we want to do. So let's convert this into some form of projection angle. Now what I've got here is I've got the same vector A, and I've got an A prime vector drawn on the XY plane down at the bottom. So what I'm planning on here is I want to calculate what A prime would be, and that's just the projection downward onto the XY plane, and from there we can project up to the actual A vector. If we look at it straight from above, we can draw this with this is the X and the Y, kind of tipping it downward, so positive X is downward. But if I draw that A prime vector, I know from my Cartesian coordinates up here, I see that I have 6 in the Y direction, I have 2 in the X direction from here and here. So I know my A prime is A prime equals 2i plus 6j. And the I, J, and these A's are all vectors. I know the magnitude of A prime equals the square root of 2 squared plus 6 squared, and that's equal to 6.32. I also know that if I look at the angle between A and A prime right there, I have the length of the hypotenuse, which is our vector of 7, and I have this y or z direction magnitude here from above, that is 3. I know I can find the angle between the vector and the xy plane. I'll call that theta z for lack of a better term, and that's equal to the inverse sine of the opposite side 3 over the hypotenuse 7, and that's equal to 25.4 degrees. And again, looking from above, I know that the length of A prime is 6.23, and I can get the angle from the x-axis here, we'll call that theta x, equal to the, in this case, inverse cosine of the adjacent side, which we determined to be 2 over the hypotenuse, which is at 6.32, and that's equal to 71.56. And for the fun of it, if I wanted to calculate the angle from the y-axis on that xy plane down there, that would be the inverse cosine of the y dimension, which is 6 over the hypotenuse, which is 6.632, and that's equal to 18.43. And if I add those two together, I get very close to 90 degrees, so I'm somewhat confident I did that correct. So if we look over to the left, this has a magnitude of 7 on the vector A. We have the angle 25.4 between the vector and the xy plane, and we have the angle of 71.56 between the x-axis and the vector A prime. So that is a way of expressing this vector in section angles. Okay. Now let's slide down one more screen here. And now we have a situation where we are given the magnitude of the vector is equal to 7. That's just the magnitude. We have the theta xy equal to 25.4 degrees. We have the angle between the x-axis and A prime equals 71.56 degrees. Can I get it back to my coordinate angles? Well, step one is to convert it to a Cartesian coordinate, right? So I have the angle between the vector and that xy plane given at 25.4, so I can pretty much determine that the magnitude of the z component is directly equal to 7, the hypotenuse, times the sine of 25.4, and that's equal to 3 meters. And if we look, we have these lines drawn here and here going to the tip, and they intersect the Z three, so that's comforting. And I have A prime, can calculate that from the angle and from the magnitude of A. So that's going to be equal to 7 times the cosine of that 25.4, and that's equal to 6.32 meters, and that's the same number we had above, so chances are we got something right. And given A prime in that xy plane, I can calculate A sub x is equal to the hypotenuse is 6.32 for the A prime vector, and times the cosine of the angle between the x-axis and A prime, which we have listed there at 71.56, and that's equal to 2.0 meters, which is the same as we had above, and AY is the 6.32 times the sine of 71.56. That's equal to 6 meters. And so we've got our final expression in Cartesian coordinates. We can say that the vector A is equal to, this is a Y, 2i plus 6j vector plus 3k vector. And if we went up above, I think that's the values we found here. Yeah, 2, 6, and 3. So moving down here, I've rewritten the Cartesian format here, and we know that the magnitude A equals 7. So I can calculate my projection angles because I have a hypotenuse. If I look for alpha, the adjacent side is the x-axis. The hypotenuse is our vector, which is 7, so that I can say that alpha equals the inverse cosine of 2 over 7, and that comes out to 73.4 degrees. Beta equals the inverse cosine of 6 over 7. That's equal to 31.0 degrees, and that's enough to specify everything. Just for the sake of entertainment, I'm going to calculate gamma equals the inverse cosine of 3 over 7, and that gives me 64.6 degrees. And if we go upstairs, 73, 31, and 64, I think we'll find that those are the same angles that we had before. We had gone full circle and got back to where we started. But the process, you just have to look at your triangles and see, you know, what planes they're in, and do you sine, cosine, inverse sine, inverse cosine, and you can go back and forth, and those give you the results that you need. And once you've done this a couple times, it becomes much less confusing. That's why I said get out the pencil and paper. Plus, that way you can read your own handwriting and not mine. Okay, I promised that we'd explain why the cosine squared alpha, cosine squared beta, cosine squared gamma is equal to 1. We'll start out just looking at this xy plane here. And Pythagorean's theorem, I know that the magnitude of A prime on that xy plane is equal to the x distance squared, A prime squared, I should say, is equal to x squared plus y squared. And if I look at the A prime ZA triangle, I get A squared equals A prime squared plus Z squared. Okay, should be straightforward. And I can substitute in there and I get the A squared equals X squared plus Y squared plus Z squared. And of course, I can take square root of both sides and I get A equals the square root of X squared plus Y squared plus Z squared. Okay, where A and A is the hypotenuse. That we've used before. Just be careful you don't get hypotenuse confused with another leg when you use that. But if I take this equation here and I divide through by A squared, I get 1 equals X over A quantity squared plus Y over A quantity squared plus Z over A quantity squared. And we know that X over A is equal to the cosine of alpha. Y over A is equal to the cosine of beta. And Z over A is equal to the cosine of gamma. So substituting back in there, I get that identity that we used at the beginning, cosine of alpha squared plus the cosine of beta squared plus the cosine of gamma squared equals 1. And that's how it rolls. Okay? I hope you found this informative. Thank you for watching, and I hope enjoy the rest of the series if that's what you're looking for, and see you later. Bye.